1, 2, 3, 4.
Hi, everyone.
Hello.
We are so happy that you're here with us. We're going to have such a wonderful time going through four different stories with our theme Black Is. I am Elizabeth, and this is my awesome friend, Amanda. Amanda, do you want to share what is your ethnic, racial background, what pronouns you go by, and who is your favorite Black hero?
Yes, absolutely. I am half Haitian and half Dominican, which is very interesting because they're actually from the very same island, which used to be Hispaniola. And there's actually a history of Dominicans and Haitians not always getting along, but they actually have interacted a lot more than history has taught us. And my parents actually met here in the US and got married and had me. I go by she, her, and my favorite Black hero is the Broadway actress Audra McDonald. She has won 6 Tonys, more than any other actress ever, and is the only one to win one in every acting category. And I'm just so inspired by her for being such a force in a industry that is very much run by Caucasians and has not originally been started for people who look like her. And I also admire that her voice is so beautifully classically trained, even though a lot of people of color on Broadway are usually expected to use more of a chest sound and sing in a belt style and always get cast in contemporary roles. I love that she's been able to sing the same ingenue and legit roles like Carousel. She was Carrie Pippridge in Carousel with Miss, not the same version with Miss Kelly O'Hara, but doing the same types of roles that Kelly O'Hara does, even though she is the typical type of person who would typically do those roles. So yeah, that's my spiel.
A very beautiful response, and I learned so much more about Audra McDonald. That's so awesome. So yeah, funny enough, I am obviously Black, Dominican. I was born in the US. I love my Haitian neighbors. I do have Haitian ancestry, so that is still woven within my ethnic background in a bit. I go by she, her, and my favorite Black hero is Ida B. Wells. She was a very important journalist at the time where a lot of horrible things were happening to Black people and in her community. And she was very outspoken and she was brazen and she was tough. And it was rumored that she lived during the Victorian era. And so women would wear like these dresses, these Victorian dresses. So she would wear her Victorian dress and underneath her dress, she'd like carry a knife, which I really appreciated. I thought that was pretty cool. Hopefully she never had to use it for anything, but just in case something happens, sort of a thing. Completely different from your hero, Amanda, but they're heroes nonetheless.
That is so exciting. I never knew that about her.
Yes, that is true. All right, so we're gonna get into why we're calling this story time Black Is, because Black is intersectional. And so you're thinking, intersectional, that's a big word. What does that mean? Well, intersectional means being part of many different groups. And so what we've talked about, so I am, you can see from my earrings, Afro-Latina. So I have both Black and Hispanic roots, and I'm also, I go by she, her, and we have different interests. And so we want to be able to celebrate that being Black is beautiful and awesome, and that there's different ways to be Black. So for instance, more examples on that, I am Black and I have important things to say, like Ida B. Wells. I'm Black and I just want to have a little sibling, and I'm kind and sensitive and sweet. I am Black and my hair is awesome. Look at our manes. Amanda too, girl, show them your hair. I have all these different personalities. I am Black and I love to sing and dance, like Amanda's hero. So being Black, there's so many different expressions of being Black. And so we're gonna celebrate the many different ways of doing that. And we're gonna talk about four specific themes. Black is liberation. It's about freedom and empowerment and how far we've come. Black is LGBTQIA+, a beautiful community of people who love different people and want to express themselves in different ways, that a lot of ways they are treated in a very horrible way. And so we want to celebrate the LGBTQ community because they're super awesome. Another theme is Black is beautiful, and there's things about being Black that people might think to be a negative thing, but it's not true. It's very beautiful, so we're celebrating that. And Black is worldwide. Black people live in the United States, we live in Latin America, we live in the Caribbean, we live in Asia, we live in Europe, we live in Africa, obviously, maybe Antarctica. Is there Black people in Antarctica? Maybe, I don't know. If there isn't people in Black, and if there isn't Black people in Antarctica, maybe you're the first one to go there. But yeah, so we wanna celebrate the internationalness of Blackness as well. So we're gonna get to our first awesome story. Black is liberation. And so I really like the story because with liberation, we don't always get an opportunity to hear how awesome Black people are and our history. And so we're gonna do that. But also sometimes we have these big words. So big word alerts. In this book, we're gonna talk about the word proclamation. Whoa, that's a lot of syllables. Just means a very important announcement. As a matter of fact, this announcement is so important that you gotta like go into an important building, open up the window and yell at people, hey everybody, I have a proclamation. So just remember about that word as we get into our first story. Our first story is Juneteenth for Maize by Floyd Cooper. Maize wants to play outside, but it's too late. It's getting dark, Maize. It's time to stay inside. Maize wants a cookie, but it's time for bed. Not now, little one. It's too close to bedtime. Maize wants to stay up late, but she's too little. Bedtime is the rule, sweet girl. Why so grumpy, Sugar Bear? Asked Dad. I can't go where I want, have what I want, or do what I want, answers Maize. Well, tomorrow you can have a celebration, says Dad. What are we celebrating? Asks Maize. We will celebrate the day your great, great, great grandpa Mose crossed into liberty. The day will be celebrated by us and many more families on a day we call Juneteenth. Dad lifts Maize into his arms. I bet you're tired of hearing no all the time. Well, great, great, great grandpa Mose heard no even more. We'll get into that in a second. Grandpa Mose worked in fields that stretch all the way to sunset. He and the other slaves would be bone tired, but they had to keep going. Their masters wouldn't let them quit, but as they worked, they thought about freedom. And before they finally went to sleep at night, they prayed about freedom and made plans for change and a better future. Some slaves ran north to freedom, following a bright star in the sky. They sweat, they bled, and they cried till those cries were quieted by a single proclamation from a brave president. Grandpa Mose heard that proclamation read from the balcony of a hotel on that warm June day in Galveston, Texas. Grandpa Mose heard nothing but cheers, saw nothing but happiness, and felt nothing but pride shared by all those around him. The cheers became dancing, the dancing became celebrating, and went on and into the night. Grandpa Mose and the others had found freedom. They continued to work, but this time they were paid for their hard work. So they worked and they saved, and they never forgot the moment they heard, the moment that changed their lives forever. But things weren't perfect. Black people still struggled to stand shoulder to shoulder with white people. They still weren't treated as equals. It wasn't easy, but they never gave up. And every year on Juneteenth, they remembered. They marched for jobs. They lobbied for schools and the right to vote. They shouted for opportunity. And every year on Juneteenth, they celebrated and remembered. They learned and they grew. They forgave. They excelled and achieved. They became heroes. Now, sweet Maisie, it's your turn to celebrate just like great, great, great Grandpa Mose. It's your turn, Maisie, to eat some barbecue and drink some strawberry pop. It's your turn to celebrate and to remember. On June 19th, 1865, soldiers arrived in Galveston, Texas, announcing the end of the Civil War and the end of slavery in the United States. It was more than 2 years after President Lincoln's Emancipation Proclamation. Celebrated every year on June 19th, Juneteenth commemorates the announcement of the abolition of slavery and the emancipation of African American citizens throughout the entire United States. All right. That is our first book. Now we're gonna get into Black is LGBTQIA. And we're gonna talk about a cute, adorable, wonderful story of little Aiden, who's going to be a big brother. Now, before we get into the story, big word alert, transgender. Now, what does that mean? That sounds like a cool word. Well, it means when a person's gender is different from what they were born with. So for instance, if you were born a boy, but you know that you're actually a girl, or you were born a girl, or you knew that you're actually a boy. So we're going to read the story of a person who was born a girl, but knew that he was a boy. So we're gonna read When Aiden Became a Brother by Kyle Lukoff, illustrated by Kehlani Juanita. When Aiden was born, everyone thought he was a girl. His parents gave him a pretty name, his room looked like a girl's room, and he wore clothes that other girls liked wearing. A cute room that's, you know, not what he's looking for. But as Aiden got bigger, he hated the sound of his name. He felt like his room belonged to someone else, and he always ripped and stained his clothes accidentally on purpose. Everyone thought he was just a different kind of girl. Some girls had rooms full of science experiments and bug collections. Lots of girls didn't wear dresses. But Aiden didn't feel like any kind of girl. He was really another kind of boy. It was hard to tell his parents what he knew about himself, but it was even harder not to. It took everyone some time to adjust, and they learned a lot from other families with transgender kids like him. Look at that new awesome room, totally more like Aiden. Aiden explored different ways of being a boy. He tried out lots of names until one stuck. They changed his bedroom into a place where he belonged. He also took much better care of his new clothes. Then one day, mom and dad had something to tell him. I'm going to have a baby, Mom announced. A baby, Aiden said. Does that mean I get to be a big brother? Of course, said Dad, ruffling his hair. Aiden thought that being a big brother was an important job for a boy like him. He wanted to make sure this baby would feel understood the right way. The cute family. The baby needed clothes, so Aiden and his mom went shopping. There were so many choices. Would the baby like seahorses or penguins better? Are you having a boy or a girl? Asked the lady. Aiden didn't like it when people asked if he was a boy or a girl, and he hoped the baby couldn't hear yet. He was glad when Mom just smiled and said, I'm having a baby. The baby's room needed to be painted, so Aiden and his dad went to the hardware store. Dad chose a gallon of sky blue paint, and Aiden added a puffy cloud white. Are you excited for your new brother or sister? Asked the paint guy. I'm excited to be a big brother, Aiden said. The paint guy looked confused. Aiden could tell that he wanted to ask a different question and was glad to have his dad there. The big rollers were fun to paint with. This room feels like being outside, Aiden exclaimed. He had always felt trapped in his bedroom before they fixed it, but his new sibling wouldn't have to feel that way. You're right, said Dad. Let's make some shapes into these clouds. All those baby names Aiden's trying to figure out. Every baby needs a name. Aiden loved getting to choose his own, but he remembered that it had been hard for his parents to let go of the name they gave him. He looked for names that could fit this new person, no matter who they grew up to be. Babies need someone to read to them, so Aiden practiced and practiced and practiced. Dad wanted to teach Aiden how to change diapers. Maybe later, said Aiden. He decided that picking flowers for his mom was more important. 2 weeks before the baby's due date, Aiden started to worry. Maybe he should have picked different clothes. The blue walls might be too bright. He wished he could ask the baby which name they liked best. There he is, scared, with his awesome blanket. Mom came to tuck him in. Are you feeling okay, sweetie? She asked. Aiden put his hands over where he thought the baby's ears would be. Do you think the baby would be happy with everything? He whispered. I don't want them to feel like I did when I was little, but what if I get everything wrong? What if I don't know how to be a good big brother? Mom hugged him tight. When you were born, we didn't know you were going to be our son. We made some mistakes, but you helped us fix them. And you taught us how important it is to love someone for exactly who they are. This baby is so lucky to have you, and so are we. The next morning, Aiden found the boxes of his old baby pictures. He looked so different back then. It hadn't been easy, but he liked the boy he was growing up into. Maybe everything wouldn't be perfect for this baby. Maybe he would have to fix mistakes he didn't even know he was making. And maybe that was okay. It's a baby. Aiden knew how to love someone, and that was the most important part of being a brother. Now, I would also like to read the author's note because it's very important and is very awesome. When I was born, everyone thought I was a girl, but my story is very different from Aiden's. I don't have a little sibling, but I do have a big brother. I liked wearing dresses, and it took me much longer to discover that I was a boy. Of course, some parts of my story are very much like Aiden's. That might be true for you too. If you're a kid who's transgender like Aiden, or transgender but not like Aiden, I'm hoping this story helps you understand what you're feeling and helps you talk about it if you're ready. You might also feel like Aiden in other ways. He knows what it's like to not quite belong, and you might feel that way too sometimes. people don't always see Aiden how he wants to be seen, and you might know what that feels like. Maybe you worry about making mistakes. Aiden is a transgender kid, but he's also just a kid, like you. Life for Aiden, and for all different kinds of kids, will be full of growth and change. I don't know what the future holds for him, but I hope he lives in the world that supports and believes in him. Thank you for helping to create that world. All right, on to you, Amanda.
Woohoo! All right, so the next topic that we are going to cover is Black is Beautiful. And to cover this topic, we are going to read the book Hair Love by Academy Award-winning creator Matthew A. Cherry, illustrated by Vashti Harrison. My name is Zuri, and I have hair that has a mind of its own. It kinks, coils, and curls every which way. Daddy tells me it is beautiful. That makes me proud. I love that my hair lets me be me. In funky braids with beads, I am a princess. And when my hair is in two puffs, I am above the clouds like a superhero. My hair even does magic tricks. One day, Rocky and I were playing outside when along came the rain. From large to small, it went, presto, just like that. There's nothing my hair can't do. Today, I woke up extra early all by myself. I was too excited to sleep. It's a big day. Daddy was still sleeping. Shh, I said to Rocky as we tiptoed past him. Lately, Daddy has been worn out. He makes me breakfast, takes me to school, goes to work, picks me up, and yesterday we went for a bike ride around the park. I think he needs a break. Because today is special, I want a perfect hairstyle. This calls for a professional's touch. Huzzah for Rocky. Daddy heard the crash. Zuri, what on earth? He asked. I was only trying to help, I said. Daddy smiled. Can I help too? It'll be a piece of cake, Zuzu. The first eye was a big no way. The second was no better. No, Daddy. Then Daddy tried slicking my hair back into two puffs. Ouch, Daddy yelled. Wait a minute, Daddy said as he reached into the drawer and pulled out a pick. Ta-da! Daddy, really? I said. I'll be right back, he promised. Now how's that? He asked, pulling a hat over my eyes. Daddy, come on. We can do better than that. I really need my hair to be special. Don't worry, he said. We'll figure this out. Then I had a great idea. Daddy gathered all the tools we needed and we were set. Watching carefully, Daddy combed, parted, oiled, and twisted. He nailed it. Funky puff buns! Pretty, pretty, and so much fun. Rocky approved, too. I put on my superhero cape as the final touch to a perfect look. Where's my Zuzu? Mommy called from the door. She could not get in the house fast enough. Mommy! You've got to be the prettiest Supergirl I've ever seen, she said. And your hair is beautiful, Zuri. Who did it? I looked at Daddy and beamed. Mommy smiled. Very nice. Thank you. We learned from the best, Daddy said as he gave her a big hug. My hair is Mommy, Daddy, and me. It's hair love. So before we move on to Black is Worldwide, I wanted to talk a little bit about why I chose Hair Love. I love this story because I like that it teaches us how we need to love every single part of ourselves, even if it's not easy. I love that it teaches us that even if it's hard, it doesn't make it bad. Because I know that for a lot of us women of color, our hair is not the easiest to deal with, and that causes us to have a lot of resentment towards it. But this book shows us that sometimes hard work pays off, and that the good things in life don't always come easy. And I think that's a beautiful lesson to learn. So now, moving on, Black is Worldwide. Do-do-do-do. Before we even get into this, we're going to be talking about Celia Cruz. She was the queen of salsa, and her music is defined as Afro-Cuban music. So that's a big word. So Afro-Cuban music is music that comes from the slaves who were brought from West Africa to Cuba in the 16th and 19th centuries, between the 16th and 19th centuries. So keep that in mind as we get through this beautiful, lovely book. Celia Cruz, Queen of Salsa, by Veronica Chambers, illustrated by Julie Marin. In the fabled land of Havana, where rhythm grows sweet and juicy, like the oranges in Florida, there lived a girl. She looked like a girl and talked like a girl, but everyone who ever met her agreed she sang like a bird. When Celia Cruz was a girl growing up in Cuba, she could never hear the magic that others claimed was in her voice. When she opened her mouth to sing, she heard a girl like any other. But when she sang, her father heard thunder. Her cousins heard the call of the sea. Her neighbors heard a hummingbird. Celia would grow up to be a queen, but she was not born a princess. She grew up in a poor section of town, one of four sisters, though the house was also home to numerous cousins. At times, there were as many as 14 children in the two-bedroom house. That's a lot of people. Still, young Celia always stood out amongst the crowd. Her mother liked to tell the story of how a tourist bought Celia's first pair of shoes after hearing the little girl sing. Like other girls in Havana, she had chores. Some of her friends were charged with sweeping the kitchen. Other girls washed the dinner plates. Celia's job was to sing lullabies to put her younger brothers and sisters to sleep. At night, her voice carried through the windows, rolling along the cobblestone streets, like a wheel or a wish. The people in her neighborhood began to gather outside of her family's front door, begging her father to leave it open. They said, "Her voice is tan dulce, sweet like azúcar." Azúcar is sugar in English. Her voice, it was said, sent you not only to sleep, but to a nighttime land of angel dreams. Always shy and more than a little independent, Celia mistook the gathering crowds for busybodies, watching her every move. Ay, por favor, she pleaded. If you don't leave, these little ones will never get to sleep. Ay, por favor means, oh, please. She was begging these people to leave, not knowing that they just loved her beautiful voice. Despite her initial shyness, she could not stop singing. In the afternoon, after school, she would listen to the rapid-fire calls and cries of the pregón, the street vendors, calling out their wares. In time, people would recognize the passion and pulsating cries of the pregón and Celia's unique vocal style. In high school, she began singing in school shows and local clubs. The music that she loved, El Son and La Guaracha, blended traditional Afro-Cuban rhythms with the flavor and folklore of the tropics. It was the kind of music that sizzled from the joy of being alive. Her father loved to watch his little songbird, watch her send 100 hearts, soaring with her melodies, but he was also cautious, keep studying Mija, which is an affectionate way to say my daughter. He told her as she hummed old Cuban love songs while absentmindedly flipping the pages of her school books. You are so smart. Forget about singing and become a school teacher and make our family proud. Her teachers, however, saw things a different way. Take a chance, one professor told her. With your voice, you could earn in a day what it takes me a year to make. But it is not easy to take a dream planted in your heart and make it grow in the world. Celia was unknown and did not have the kind of connections that easily open doors. Still, she jumped at every opportunity, talent contest at the National Theater, and amateur nights on the radio. She never forgot her father's lessons on the importance of education. And after graduating high school, she enrolled in Cuba's National Music Conservatory, where she studied piano, voice, and musical theory. Then in 1950, she got her big shot. The most popular band of the day was a group called La Sonora Matancera, and they were auditioning for a new lead singer. When they heard Celia sing, the way she made each and every note swing, they decided to give the little songbird a job. Oh, such a pretty picture. At first, La Sonora's public was outraged. Who was this no-name singer fronting their favorite band? The phones at the Havana radio stations rang off the hook with complaints. At home, Celia began to wonder if she shouldn't take her father's advice and teach school. Was she really the ruin of Cuba's most beloved band? She stood by the window, looking out at the stars she feared she would never join. And Celia asked herself, why do I sing? Is it for fame and fortune and for fans that do not exist? No, she told herself. I sing for my parents, the ancestors, and the saints. I sing because when I lift my voice up high, I feel like the first pajaro of the day, whistling buenos dias to anyone who will listen. Pájaro is a bird. I sing for my little brothers and sisters and the sweet expressions on their faces when they finally fall asleep. Although Celia was seriously thinking about giving up her dream, her bandmates refused to allow her to quit. As a group, they rewrote the history of Cuban music with new arrangements and a fresh, innovative style. By the time she left Cuba in 1960, Celia was as beloved throughout the country as the men who made music with her. She'd even earned an affectionate nickname from her thousands of fans. They called the group Café con Leche, coffee with milk, because Celia's skin was very dark and her bandmates were very fair. Look at all them dancing. In the United States, she became a citizen and her talent was rewarded with a permanent contract at the Hollywood Palladium. But when she left Cuba, politics dictated that she could never return. She would never again walk the streets of her beloved Havana. She would never again hear the cries of the pigeon that were the bass and treble of Cuban street life. It was a heartache she carried her whole life through. Still, she kept her heart open. Lost loves made room for new loves. And it was there, in Hollywood, that factory town of movies and dreams, that the young princess of salsa music fell in love with a knight in shining armor. His name was really Knight, Pedro Knight. He was the lead trumpet player of the Palladium Orchestra. And while he dazzled her with his high notes, he won her love with his understanding. She told him that her heart would always be split in three places, and only one part would belong to him. One part of her heart belonged to the music, and the third piece would always live in Cuba. Celia knew that she had met more than her husband. She had met an angel who would be her companion and protector in this land so far away from home. Celia Cruz brought salsa music to every corner of the earth, from London to the Congo, from Brazil to Japan. She recorded over 20 gold albums and is known over the world as the Queen of Salsa. For more than 40 years, Pedro Knight was her king. Celia's performance trademark was a full-throated shot of azúcar. It's the Spanish word for sugar, and the only word many say that so perfectly described her voice. In the fabled land of Havana, where rhythm grows, sweet and juicy like oranges in Florida, there lived a girl. She looked like a girl and talked like a girl. But everyone who ever met her agreed, she sang like a bird. The bird girl grew into a princess, and the princess became a much beloved queen. Her kingdom was music, and those who loved her called her not by name, but by the joy she inspired. At concerts, they called out azúcar, and Celia Cruz never failed them. She sung sugar, sweet sugar, wherever she went. So that's the story of the lovely Celia Cruz. So the author, Veronica Chambers, is a huge fan of princesses like me. And that's one of my favorite parts of the book, that she relates her stories to Celia being a princess. And I love that she was so universal. And I love how influential her music was, because she really really did change the entire face of Afro-Cuban music. And I love that she did face challenges from her own family, kind of holding her back and telling her that she should just only be a teacher and not fully go for it, even though they knew she was very talented. Because it's always scary to have your own child put themselves at risk for something that's so, that's not always rewarding and not super lucrative as a career in the performing arts. But I love that eventually her dad did come around and that it worked out for her and that we're all so blessed to listen to her music now. It's a beautiful story that I hope you all really enjoyed. But now we can look at how Black is full of resources. You can go to your local libraries to read any of these books because they're all available to you. You can try to go to Black-owned bookstores instead of just Barnes and Nobles. Even though we love Barnes and Nobles, it's always good to support Black-owned businesses because they do so much for us and they need it. They need our love and support. These are such, all of these books are amazing. So you should go add them to your own personal collections.
Yes.
I don't know if you guys all know this, but this book, Hair Love, is actually a short film, which is free for everybody to watch on YouTube. So definitely go on YouTube to watch that. And all of Celia Cruz's music is on Spotify, and there is a playlist of some of her best songs called This is Celia Cruz. And we are going to end this amazing, amazing session that we've had with you guys with her song, La Vida es un Carnaval. Yes. I hope you guys enjoy it.
I still feel like I have to.
History Month. Thank you so much for joining us.
Yes, thank you so much. We love you.
We really do. Thank you.
Bye. T stands for time or checking out. Take as one.